Good morning, church. Let us join together as we sing our praises to the Lord.
Oh, raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I'll raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I'll raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. I'll raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me.
I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm, louder and louder, gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated, the King is alive.
My strength, my song, this cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled and striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe. This gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on that cross as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid, here in the death of Christ I live. Ground his body lay, light of the world by darkness slain. Then bursting forth in glorious day, out from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, sin's curse has lost its grip on me. And as he stands in victory, sin's curse has lost its grip on me. For I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. The power of Christ in me, from life's first cry till final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand. No power of hell, no scheme of man could ever pluck me from his hand. Till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ I'll stand. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. It's so good to be back with you, especially back here in California, where the weather is so beautiful. I'm very excited that we're able to host some events in person now. So be sure to check your emails and come and join us. And let's go ahead and pray before we jump into our new message series for this month. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for how good you are to us, for meeting every one of our needs, for being our loving Father, and for being our best friend. And I just pray that during this sermon series that we would learn more about what it means to be found by you, that we would learn and remember that the King of the universe seeks after us and wants to have a relationship with us and loves us more than anybody could ever love us. And I just pray that you'd be with us now during this time. Please speak to us and help us to fall more in love with Jesus this week and through every day of our lives as we walk with you. And we love you so much. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So let's, before we jump into our next sermon series, let's just review real quickly from last month what we talked about. And before we get into last month, I just want to ask you again, how are your New Year's resolutions going? Are you following through on the commitments that you made to yourself and to God for this year so far? I've still been pretty good about reading the Bible almost every day and praying every day, and I'm falling more in love with Jesus every day. I've been good about working out. As you can see, I'm getting in better shape. I've been pretty good about my New Year's resolutions. I've even started eating healthier too. So how about you? How are your New Year's resolutions going? But last month, we learned that rules are in place to protect us, and they're put in place by those who love us, like God and our parents and our leaders. And we also talked a lot about the way to find true freedom. True freedom is found when you love God and others, which is the greatest commandment. And the most important thing I want you to remember from last month is that our main focus shouldn't be on following a list of rules, but on following and knowing Jesus. And then he will change our hearts so that we will want to honor him and honor those around us that God has put in place in our lives. And as you can see, I put that verse, that we those verses that we talked about last month too, the greatest commandment. This week, we are starting a new fantastic series called Lost and Found. And before we get started, I wanted to share a video of some owners and their dogs playing hide and go seek. Now, if we were in person, we would play a real game of hide and go seek, but unfortunately, we can't meet in person yet. Or at least, you know, we would play something like that. So I remember that we actually had a lock-in last year, and we played hide-and-go-seek in the church. So I hope we can have another one of those soon. But let's go ahead and direct our attention to the screen, let's watch this video together.
Thank you.
All right, so unless you're an alien, then you've played hide and seek. Probably not with an animal like this, but you've played hide and go seek. And I want to ask you, have you ever lost something? Maybe it was a favorite stuffed animal when you were younger. Maybe it was an entire school project that you lost the day before it was due. Maybe it was something that you were about to say, and then it slipped your mind, and you don't remember what it was. I want you to go ahead and put in the chat something that you've lost before. I remember I lost my phone for a few hours, and I couldn't find it. And it was really, really hard to function without my phone. There are tons of reasons why we lose things. Sometimes it's because we're careless. Sometimes we lose things because we get distracted. And sometimes we get lost because the thing we're trying to navigate, like a city or a tough math problem, are new or confusing. We all know how frustrating it is to lose something we love or need. But sometimes it's not just our phones or homework that get lost. Sometimes it's us. Have you ever gotten lost before? If you did, how did you feel? And I'd love to hear your story of being lost sometime, maybe when we'll meet in person. I remember one time I got lost, and it was kind of a funny story. I was spending the night at one of my friend's houses, and I woke up in the middle of the night, and I stood up, and I had no idea where I was. I was like, what in the world? Where am I? I thought I was in a dream. I felt around me, and it felt kind of hard. You know, it felt like I was like lying in a hard like plastic bed. And then I turned the lights on, and I was standing in a bathtub. I don't know what happened or how I got in the bathtub. Maybe my friend was trying to play a prank on me, but I never found out how I got there. But I felt very lost in that moment. And you know, it's kind of fun to look back at those times when we have gotten lost on those stories. But if we're honest, it probably wasn't very fun in the moment when we were lost. It's pretty scary to be lost. If you lost your stuffed animal as a kid or your phone right now, it would probably feel the same way. You'd be really sad and really maybe feeling hopeless. Whether you wander away from your parents, take a wrong turn, or lose track of your friends in a crowd, it can be scary to realize that you're not sure where you are and who to ask for help or how to get home again. And for the next few weeks, we're going to talk a lot about lost things and how they got found. But this won't be a lesson on how to find our lost phone or lost homework. We'll talk about the ways that we can get lost, how we can help others when they're getting lost, and how we can all get found again. There was a time in my life where I started going against God, believe it or not, and I was spiritually lost. And even though I was a Christian, I was not walking with God. It was my senior year of high school. There's a picture of me when I was a senior. There's me on the left with my family, and then on the right with the person that made me get lost or caused me to get lost. So there was this girl that that I started dating, and I didn't really want a girlfriend my senior year of high school, but this girl kind of approached me and started chasing after me and pursuing me. And so I was like, you know, I'll just give it a shot. And I'll never forget, you know, this girl's name. Her name was Becca. And I started dating her, and it was a bad idea. I mean, the main reason is because she said that she was a Christian, but you know, you couldn't tell by her life that she actually loved God. You couldn't tell by her fruit that she was a believer. And so she led me down the wrong path, and it led to a lot of heartache. It led to me feeling far from God. It led to me making unwise choices, and it led me to experiencing doubt, and I really struggled. And honestly, I still kind of struggle with some of the emotional baggage that relationship caused. And one thing that happened was she actually kind of cheated on me while I was in China on a missions trip. So I won't go into details about that, but it was really, really sad, and it was heartbreaking to me. And I won't tell you how that situation ended up now. I'll tell you later on. So when it comes to your faith, there are a lot of reasons why you might feel lost sometimes. And see, you and I were created to be close to the God who made and loves us. And the reason why I tell that story is because many times One of the biggest things that leads people away from God is the wrong kind of relationship with someone that God doesn't have for you. So I just want to encourage you and challenge you that if it's not clear that God wants you, and I know you're young, but if it's not clear that God wants you to date this person, if this person is not a Christian and is not godly, then it's not worth your time or energy or emotions to pursue a relationship with them, because ultimately it will hurt you in the long run. So there's that little rabbit trail for you, a little piece of advice and wisdom. So some of us don't know who our Creator is yet. So we are lost in that sense. Some of us maybe know Jesus, but we wander far away from him by making unwise decisions or turning our backs on him. Some of us know Jesus, but we're struggling with what we believe, with a difficult situation we're in, or maybe even with our mental health. In all of these situations, we can feel pretty lost sometimes. If you drive, walk, or bike, you've probably used an app like this on your phone. It's called the Google Maps app. And this keeps us from getting lost by telling us exactly what to do and when. It helps us to avoid roadblocks. It helps us to avoid danger. And it lets us know exactly how long it will take to get us to our destination. And a lot of times it will automatically reroute us when we take a wrong turn. And as you can see on my map right there, I put two places that are some of my favorite places in California. I like to go to Wingstop pretty regularly, so I put that on my maps. And I also like to go to Yosemite. Now, I can get to Wingstop without the Maps app, but I can't get to Yosemite without the Maps app. I would probably get lost, or it'd take me a lot longer to get there. But wouldn't it be nice to have an app that is like this, but it was for our whole lives? It wasn't just to give us directions from, you know, point A to point B, but it actually gave us directions for our whole life. Like, for example, something that tells us exactly which decisions to make and when. Something that helps us to avoid setbacks. It gives us a heads up when we're heading towards danger. It lets us take a peek into our future so we don't have to wonder or worry what's going to happen next. Automatically, it tells us what to do when we've made a bad decision. And wouldn't it be nice if an app told us how to do that with our faith too? Because let's be honest, sometimes faith can be confusing, even for me. Sometimes you feel as though you've wandered away from God, but you're not sure how or why that happened. Maybe it seems like yesterday you had an awesome relationship with God. And as you were reading the Bible, you were getting so excited about following God and loving Jesus. But then today, you feel lost and far away. Other times, you might even feel like you've wandered away from your faith. And no one notices but you. Deep down inside, you know that you're not honoring God and loving others. You see, no one notices that. Except for God, of course. If you feel far from God for whatever reason, you might find yourself wondering, who screwed up here? Who messed up here? Did I fail God, or did God fail me? And what do I do from here? You may be asking yourself all those questions. For the next 4 weeks, or next 3 weeks, we're going to be looking at one chapter of the Bible. Yeah, that's right, just one. And that's in Luke chapter 15. And this chapter recounts a series of stories Jesus once told about things that were lost and then found. And each story communicates a different and important truth. These stories aren't historical stories. They're parables, these are stories that Jesus made up and told in order to teach an important truth. And so let's direct our attention to the screen as we read in Luke chapter 15, we're going to start in verses 1 and 2. So it says, "Now the tax collectors and sinners were all drawing near to him. And the Pharisees and scribes grumbled, saying, 'This man receives sinners and eats with them.'" And so that's where we'll stop right there on this part of our screen. So it says that, so we the first question we need to ask is, who are the Pharisees? And why are they so mad? Many of you know the answer to this, but I'll go and explain. The Pharisees of Jesus' day were religious leaders who were super focused on just following God's rules. They were focused on just following a list of rules. The hundreds of laws contained in Jewish scripture. And these laws were important, and they weren't inherently bad in themselves. In fact, they were given by God to help God's people stay healthy, safe, and close to God. And these laws help people not get lost. But in Jesus' opinion, the Pharisees had taken things too far because they wanted to follow every law exactly. They became arrogant and prideful, self-righteous, and they even started to dismiss people who they believed were sinful. Kind of like just saying, you know, you're a terrible person. God can't ever love you. The Pharisees were so obsessed with following God's laws that they missed God's heart. I'll say that again because that's so important. They were so obsessed with following God's laws and rules that they missed God's heart. Now, what do I mean by that? Jesus was often angry with the Pharisees for their lack of love, mercy, and compassion for others. And if you've been joining us in our Tuesday night Bible study, we've actually talked quite a bit about this, how Jesus came for the sick and the poor, not for the people who are righteous and just follow a bunch of rules. You see, to the Pharisees, Jesus always seemed to be breaking God's rules because he would do things like heal people on the Sabbath day of rest, or he would share meals with people who the Pharisees called sinners. And instead of dismissing the Pharisees for being jerks, Jesus actually takes the time to tell them three stories to help them think differently, to show them, hey, life is not about just following a list of rules. Life is about loving others and accepting them the way that Jesus does. And the first story that we're going to read is about a missing sheep. And as we read this story, I want you to just kind of picture in your mind the kind of setting that we are talking about here. Let me show you what some of the scenery looked like in Israel. And when you see the Judean desert, you can get a better understanding of how a sheep might go missing and how difficult it might be to find it again. Let's direct our attention to the screen as we read in Luke chapter 15, starting in verse 3. So let's go ahead and read that together. It says, "So he told them this parable," this is Jesus, "what man of you, having 100 sheep, if he has lost one of them, does not leave the 99 in the open country and go after the one that is lost until he finds it? And when he has found it, he lays it on his shoulders, rejoicing. And when he comes home, he calls together his friends and his neighbor, saying to them, 'Rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep that was lost.' Just so, I tell you, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who need no repentance." And that's where we'll stop reading right there. So we can see here that Jesus is talking to the Pharisees. And we don't know how the sheep wandered away from his shepherd. Maybe it got distracted or confused. Maybe it saw another sheep walk that way, so it followed along. Maybe it was actually trying to run away. Either way, the sheep found itself far from the safety of its shepherd. Imagine how difficult it would be to find one lost sheep in that huge desert filled with valleys and steep cliffs. It would take time, effort, and a lot of attention. And if I were the shepherd, I'm not sure I'd be willing to put in that effort for one sheep. But here's what the shepherd in Jesus' story did. Even though he had 100 sheep to take care of, he noticed when one of them was missing. I imagine he knew that sheep's name too. Even though he knew it would be difficult, he searched for his lost sheep until he found it. He never gave up. And when he found his lost sheep, Jesus didn't say the shepherd yelled at it or made fun of it or punished it, kind of like the Pharisees do to other people. The shepherd lovingly carried it home. Wow, that is so amazing. And so what does this parable mean? Who is the shepherd in this story? And who is the sheep? It actually tells us in Isaiah 53:6, it gives us a great picture of this story. It says, "All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all." And as you can see in this story, Jesus is the shepherd who laid down his life for the sheep. And we are all the sheep who wander away. There's not a single person in the world who is not lost like this sheep. We all are sinners. And our sin was laid on Jesus on the cross when he took the punishment for us. And Jesus seeks for us. He wants to find us because we're all lost without him. And Jesus says that God is like that good shepherd in this story. And Jesus is God. And I want to tell you right now, because when you feel lost, Jesus notices you. Remember that time I shared earlier when I felt lost spiritually? With God's help, I was able to get through that. That year, that my senior year of high school, was one of the hardest years of my life. I went through so much trouble and difficulty. But God actually, through taking me to college, I was able to break up with that girl that was not good for me. And I was able to get away from her. And God was led me through that valley. And it took me a few months, maybe even a year, to get over that situation and to actually get my heart right with God. But one thing I noticed is that God was like the shepherd who was leading me and he was guiding me, even when I was going against him. And during that time, God was like the good shepherd to me. You know, sometimes we're all like that sheep in Jesus' story, wandering away from the safety of God, our shepherd. So maybe we wander from God because we don't know Jesus is our good shepherd in the first place. Maybe you're out in the desert wandering, and this is the first time you're realizing that Jesus has been calling you to come and be found by him, to be welcomed into his family as a son and as a daughter. The second thing is that we often get distracted. Maybe you intended to stay close to Jesus and you tried so hard, but there were so many other interesting and distracting things to do that you kind of forgot that Jesus existed. Maybe you're looking up right now and wondering, how long have I been wandering for? A third is sometimes we get confused. It's okay to have questions and uncertainties about following Jesus. That's completely natural. And those questions sometimes can turn into confusion that leads us away from our shepherd. But our questions don't need to lead us away from him. In fact, our questions can bring us closer when we bring them to God. And in a few months, we'll actually have a sermon series on doubts and questions that many people have about God. And then fourth, like what I did for a while when I was a senior in high school, we sometimes walk away from God. And sometimes we walk away from our shepherd on purpose because there's something else that we love more than Jesus. And maybe you've turned your back on God in the past because following Jesus was too difficult, or you were no longer interested, or you were hurt and you blame God for that hurt. Just like sheep are sheep, you and I are human. And God knows we're prone to getting lost. And that's why Jesus describes the good shepherd the way he does. Even though God has created hundreds of billions of people, God knows each and every one of you by name. And he knows how many hairs are on your head. He knows what you're thinking right now. And he knows all the terrible, bad, nasty things that you've done and that you've thought. And you know, he still chooses to love you. And you know, when you go missing, God notices. You're not insignificant to your shepherd, to our Father. And even though convincing us to come back to God is difficult, Jesus never stops searching for us. He never gave up on you, and he never will. And when you and I finally realize that we're lost and need help, God doesn't yell at us or make fun of us or punish us. When you need help, God celebrates, like this shepherd in the story who rejoiced when that one sheep, he was able to find that one sheep. And Jesus will always lovingly carry you home. Just like the shepherd in the parable notices his missing sheep, Jesus notices you. Yes, you. You who are sitting here thinking about how far you've wandered and wondering how you're going to find your way back. Jesus notices you. And you who feel like no one in the world notices you. You feel like you're insignificant and you're invisible sometimes. Jesus notices you. And you who are still trying to decide what you think about God, you may not even believe in him. You may not even want to believe in him. I want to tell you that Jesus notices you. He loves you, and he wants to have a relationship with you. And that's amazing because there's no one else in the world that's like that. And before I pray, I want us to listen to this song together. And if you're watching this on YouTube, you can just pause this video and click on the song below. But as we're listening, I want you to pay attention to the words, and I want you to thank Jesus for being our good shepherd who takes such good care of us and is always there to receive us and welcome us back into his arms. So let's go ahead and watch this song and listen to the words as we watch.
Take me to the church and I'll pray. Take me to the river and I'll wash my sins away. Take me to the church and I'll pray. Take me to the river and I'll wash my sins away. I'll dance in the water there. I'll hardly come up for air. 'Cause in the waters of new life I'm found, and all the world is right. Take me by the hand and lead this wanderer home. Would you go with me as I walk this road? Take me by the hand and lead this wanderer home. Home. They're still so far from me to climb. If I forget that you are mine, when the road in front of me gets dark, it can seem so far. But in the promise of your light I'm found, and all the world is right. There's nothing I'll bring but a whispered hallelujah as I hear the angels sing. sing. I'll stand with you in the end. I'll hear you call me your friend. 'Cause where my faith becomes my sight, I'm found and all the world is right.
All right, so here are my hopes for you today. I really hope that song spoke to you and encouraged you and showed you that Jesus is there waiting with open arms to receive you into his family, to forgive you of everything you've ever done in your past, your present, and your future. Jesus died and rose from the dead so that you can have a relationship with him. And I want to let you know, this is my hope for you today. If you're not sure what you think about Jesus, or you're willing to give him a chance, then please come and talk to me or talk to one of your leaders or talk to your parents. I hope that you leave today knowing that your good shepherd loves you and is so excited to welcome you into his family. There may be another person here who's listening that you feel lost right now. I hope you leave today knowing that Jesus is actively searching for you. He's chasing after you. And let him know that you're ready to be found. And maybe today you're a kind of person who feels unseen. You feel like no one notices you. And maybe no one even cares about you. I hope you leave today knowing that Jesus sees you and he loves you and he wants to have a relationship with you. And I want you to know that when you feel lost, Jesus notices you. Let's go ahead and pray right now. God, I just thank you so much for this day, and I thank you for the story of the lost sheep and the good shepherd. Thank you so much for being such a loving father who cares for us and notices us. And we know that you see everything that we go through. You see all our doubts and questions and failures and pains. And you notice those things and you want to walk with us through those things. So I just pray that if there's anybody here who does not have you as their shepherd, who has not received you into their lives, that they would come to you because you are looking for them. You are seeking them. All we have to do is accept that free gift that you offer us. Thank you so much for loving us. Thank you for the word of God and for the story of the Good Shepherd. And help us to continue to listen for your voice as you guide us and as we, your sheep, listen to your voice. We love you so much. Thank you for loving us. And it's in Jesus' precious name that we pray. Amen. All right, I hope you have a good rest of the day. Enjoy your week.
Generation. rising up to take their place with selfless faith, with selfless faith. I see a new revival stirring as we pray and see. We're on our knees, we're on. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna.